Not many of you guys in trouble out here. Yeah, you better watch out. You better not cry. You better not cry.
Merry Christmas!
Santa Claus is coming to town.
Merry Christmas,
Santa
everybody!
Claus is coming to town. Santa Claus is coming.
Hey! Hey, buddy! How you doing, man? Everybody, buddy, the elf!
Hello.
Wow, thank you for being here, man. You look like you came from the North Pole.
That's exactly where I came from.
How did you get here?
Did Papa Elf tell you I came?
Well, maybe. You may have said something about it. How did you get here, buddy?
Well, I came in over the hills of the twirly swirly gumdrops. I drove through the Lincoln Tunnel, got off 275 West, and ended up here.
That's awesome. Wow, you excited about Christmas?
Yes, I'm excited about Christmas.
Now, what are you so excited about this Christmas? I bet you got some good gifts to give away.
We have some great gifts. Well, the really good thing that I'm excited about this Christmas is brand new CityGate hoodies that our Elf Bernard is modeling right here, right there. Yeah, yeah. Straight from the North Pole. Straight from the North Pole. It's really, really cool. It's really, really awesome. So they're going to be for sale today out in the Life Cafe, $20 a piece. You can't beat that. It's a great stocking stuffer. Am I right, Bernard?
Well, buddy, you know, I love giving away gifts.
Yes.
And I've got a pretty cool coat on today. You know, the way I love giving away gifts and the way I'm dressed, I guess you could say I'm Santa Claus.
No, you're not.
Yeah, I'm Santa Claus.
No, you're not.
Yes, I...
No, you're not. If you're Santa Claus, what did I sing you for your birthday last year?
Happy birthday?
You're not Santa Claus.
Yeah, I like giving away gifts. I like dressing up in this cool coat. I'm Santa Claus.
Sit on a throne of lies. You smell like chili and cheese. And hot dogs. And crackers.
All right, buddy. Well, listen. We at CityGate, we love making memories here, and we want everybody today to leave filled with Christmas cheer. How do you think we fill them with Christmas cheer?
Yes. Papa Elf always told me up in the North Pole, the only way to spread Christmas cheer is singing loud for all to hear. That's right.
So, will you sing us a song?
Sing you a song.
This is your moment, buddy. Will you sing us a song today?
Now?
Yeah. Come on, everybody. Yeah, buddy, 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 buddy. Bring down the music. Bring down the music. Here we go. You ready, buddy? This is your big moment. People are watching live all over the world right now.
Okay.
You got this, buddy.
Okay. I'm singing. I'm in a church and I'm singing. I'm on stage with a lot of people looking at me and I'm singing and I'm really nervous and I'm singing.
You gonna hang around till after the service?
Yeah. And you know what? We also like to take pictures with all the kids when they come to the North Pole with Santa. So how about I come back later and then I can take pictures with all the kids if they want to.
What do you think, kids? Does that sound like fun? All right, he'll be around after the service. Everybody give it up for Buddy the Elf. Come on. Are you excited about Christmas? Give me a second while I do my Mr. Rogers bit. I am really excited about Christmas. And I'm really excited about Christmas because I love Christmas. Is there anybody in here that just loves Christmas? You just love. Hey, why don't you just right now look at somebody and just wish them a Merry Christmas? Merry Christmas. And let me say something today, because we have all of Kids Town in service with us today and all of our Kids Town volunteers. Will you join me in welcoming our Kids Town ministry today, being with us in our family service? How cool is that? Now that means that there are kids in this service, and they're going to get rowdy, and they may talk, and they may point, and they may pick their nose, but that's okay, because this is a Christmas service, so we wanted to make it just like your home, all right? We are so glad you're here today, and I've been in a series called Merry and Bright, and we've talked about the star that the wise men followed, and we have also talked about salutation, how to have a Merry Christmas. How many of you enjoyed last week? Wasn't that exciting? And here we are at our Christmas service, and one thing that's really popular right now is hand sanitizers. How many of you have hand sanitizers in your purse right now? How many of you shake hands with some people and you wait till they look away so you can't wait till you get some? I don't know where they've been. They look sketchy. We love hand sanitizers. I remember when Sage was a little girl, she was just born, Kim filled up the diaper bag with hand sanitizers. And we've had some babies born this year at CityGate Church. And I'll go to hold the baby. I mean, I'm the pastor. You think they'd want me to hold the babies? You know, bless the baby. And they're like, now, pastor, you got to sanitize your hands first. Well, the claims of these hand sanitizers is that they kill millions of germs on contact. That they eliminate. I guess the purpose is they want to eliminate these germs, these diseases from your life. And that's why we use them. We put them on because we want to eliminate something. I would argue this morning that we have become the most sanitized, and not just sanitized, but Santa-tized culture in history. We have Santa-tized Christmas. We have used Santa to eliminate something else from this season. And not just something else, someone else from this season. We have Santa-tized Christmas. Now, let me say before I even get started, I am pro-Santa. I am pro any guy that shows up at the house, gives us free gifts, and likes cookies, a man after my own heart. I like Santa Claus. I like Mrs. Claus. I like how generous they are. I like how they give away. I mean, Santa is great, but our culture has become Santa-tized. Isn't it true today that our culture is more about Santa than it is the Savior? Even Santa now, do you remember when Santa Claus used to fly away? Do you remember what he used to say? Merry Christmas to all. To all good night. He doesn't even say that anymore. Now it's Happy Holidays. Have a great winter. Even Santa Claus is steering clear of Christmas nowadays. Now again, I don't have a problem with Santa. What I have a problem with is the culture that has become Santa-tized. I remember as a kid, I remember, you know, leaving out the cookies and the milk and running upstairs because if you didn't get in bed in time, Santa Claus was going to skip over your house. You know, the kid next door is going to get your gifts, so you had to get to bed early. And I remember running upstairs, and I can still remember this, folks. I know you think I'm crazy, but I promise you one year I heard jingle bells. I know I heard jingle bells coming right down the chimney. I heard them. And I'm trying to go to sleep, but you can't. How in the world do you expect a child to go to sleep when the man who owns all the toys in the world is going to be in their house tonight? Expect me to go to sleep? But we go to sleep, and we wake up. And we run downstairs in our PJs, and we look under the tree, and there's some wrapped presents underneath the tree. Those are for mom and dad. But then there are some presents that weren't wrapped, and those were from Santa Claus. Listen, I like Santa. I don't have a problem with Santa, but I have a problem when we start using Santa to Santa-tize Christ out of Christmas. Now, there are some big differences between Santa and the Savior, and I'm going to talk about some of those differences today. Now, listen, there are some very obvious differences between Santa and the Savior that I'm not going to touch today because we have a large age demographic in the room. Parents, I'll leave that up to you. You got three choices when it comes to Santa. You can receive him, you can reject him, or you can redeem him. We choose in our house to redeem him. We believe even Santa needs Jesus. But we are Santa-tizing Christmas. Let me give you some of the differences, though, that I thought about in this season. First off, Christmas is about presents. We all love presents. How many of you love presents? In fact, turn to somebody and ask them, what did you get me? Tell them, I've sat by you all year. I've put up with you all year long. What did you get me? I got here early so you could show up 15 minutes late and I saved your seat. What did you get me? Thought it'll be a seat-saving gift. Christmas is about presents. But here's the difference I've noted. Well, first off, we know that Santa and the Savior both love to give presents. They both love to give. Here is the difference. Santa's presents are based on behavior. The Savior's presents aren't. Now, Christmas is all about giving and receiving a gift. Santa has convinced us that that's what it's about. How much can you buy? How much can you give? But most of us, and here's the problem, when we give gifts like Santa gives gifts. So today, as a matter of fact, today, on my way to church, I'm pulling out of our neighborhood. There's some cars lined up on one side of our street. So I look around, no other cars coming. So I'm, you know, just pulling out. There's enough room for two cars to go by. And this elderly gentleman appears out of nowhere and starts to drive down. Well, he's upset that I decided to drive down with cars and I didn't give him the right of way to go first. He wasn't even there. I was there first. And so when I upset him, he gives me the universal symbol of I'm upset with you. Not that one. Not that one. He didn't tell me I was number one. He didn't do that one. He gave me this one. Are you ready? How many of you ever got that? How many of you ever given that? And what that's supposed to tell me is that you're very upset with me. You don't approve of my driving. Well, you know what? I mean, it's Christmas morning. I got a lot on my mind. I thought, I'm not dealing with this today. I swung the car around. I floored it. I start following the guy. I follow him to a traffic light. I yell out the window, hey, listen, pray for your pastor. I follow him to a traffic light, and I yell out the window, hey, roll your window down. He rolls his window down. I said, hey, what's your name? He told me his name. I said, hey, what's your address? He gave me his address. I said, you go home, I'm going to the mall, and I'm going to buy you something real nice, and I'm going to bring it back to your house. No, none of that ever happened. It didn't happen. Him getting mad at me today, that happened, but none of the other stuff happened. I didn't follow him. And you know why you know that didn't happen? Because none of us would ever do that. Because we give gifts like Santa Claus gives gifts. We give gifts to people that we like and people that have been good to us. We don't ever give gifts to people that we don't like. And we don't give gifts to people that haven't been good to us. But here's what the Bible says, Paul says in Titus, beginning with verse chapter 3, verse 4. But when the goodness and the loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, verse 5, he saved us. Not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy. His own mercy. By the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit. Here's the good news for you today. Jesus' gifts are not based on your behavior, but on his righteousness. His gifts are not based on your performance, but upon his grace. See, if receiving a gift from Jesus was based on our performance, we would all be in a lot of trouble. Because in God's economy, good isn't good enough. But God is always God enough. And if God's gift was based on goodness, if it was based on behavior, we'd be in a lot of trouble. But here is the big idea. God, in the fullness of time, sent his son Jesus Christ as the ultimate Christmas present. Jesus was born and had a presence on this earth for 33 years. And at the end of his life, he died and he rose again. And the good news is this, it doesn't matter how bad you have been, you can still receive him. But it goes on further. It doesn't matter how good you've been, you still need him. Let me talk about another difference between Santa and the Savior. Santa's presence is limited. Christ's presence is unlimited. I remember a little cartoon I watched as a kid, and the kids would sing on the cartoon, Christmas comes but once a year, now is here, bringing lots of joy and cheer, fa-la-la-la-la. Isn't that great? If you'd give better, I'd sing better. Santa comes but once a year, lands on your house with those flying reindeer. I did find out something interesting. This is a true fact for you. Fun fact. Is that the caribou, the reindeer that live way up north, the male caribou, the male reindeer, shed their antlers in summer. Only the female reindeer have their antlers in winter. We wouldn't have Christmas if it wasn't for the ladies. Amen. Santa comes down your chimney with rosy red cheeks and a belly that jiggles like a bowl full of jelly. Jesus, though, he's real. He's authentic. He's a man's man. He's not there for just our whims and our wants. Pretty soon, we just came out of one. We'll be coming back into another campaign season. Politicians will be out there campaigning for your vote. They want you to vote for them. And do you know what almost every politician will do, especially candidates for president? You'll be watching the news, and one night they'll say, a presidential candidate so-and-so stopped by this car factory, and they will show the candidate putting on his hard hat and putting on his goggles, and he will walk around with everybody in the factory, and he will appear as though he's a regular blue-collar worker just like the rest of you. They have a name for this. It's called identification strategy. And do you know what? It works. When you see a candidate looks like you and is moving and operating in a place of business like you move and you operate, you begin to make a connection with you and that candidate that he is just like you. There's only one problem. He's not going to give up his paycheck to go work in that factory. He's not going to give up the fame to go work in that factory. They're not going to give up all the attention to go work in that factory. But come Monday morning, you'll be clocking in again. Here's the good news. Jesus didn't just come to earth to pose for a picture. This was God who had all power. He didn't need to be identified with you, yet he became Emmanuel, which means God with us. He didn't just come down and walk with us. No, he put our human flesh on. He felt like you felt. He experienced what you experience. You see, Santa can't provide what only Christ can. For one thing, Santa's only around once a year. When January winds chill your soul, Santa Claus is history. When December's requests become February's payments, Santa has left them all. When April demands taxes and May brings final exams, Santa is still months from his next visit. And should July find us ill or October find us alone, you can't go to his chair for comfort. It's still empty. He only comes once a year. And you may be feeling today with all that you're going through, you're right, Pastor, but Santa Claus is only symbolic of everybody in my life. Nobody understands what I'm going through. Nobody understands the pressure that I'm dealing with this Christmas. Nobody understands how hard it is. But I want you to learn two words. Are you ready? Two words. Accept Jesus. Nobody knows what it's like to feel the weight of the world on their shoulders like me. I'm a single mother and I'm working two jobs and trying to go to school to give a better life for my children. And I feel like I got the weight of the world on my shoulder. Nobody understands, two words, except Jesus. Nobody knows what it feels like to be betrayed. Nobody knows what it feels like to have your heart broken. Nobody knows what it feels like to have your life ripped out of your chest and stomped on the ground. Two words, except Jesus. Jesus. And those two words will carry you through this Christmas season. Here's another difference I found. Santa's gifts are what we want. Jesus's gifts are what we need. So I asked Sage yesterday. We were on our way somewhere, and I asked Sage, I said, Sage, tell me something. What do you think the biggest difference between Santa and Jesus are? And she thought about it for a second. She said, well, they both like giving stuff. And I said, that's right. But what's the difference? She said, and I'm telling you, as a father, this one made me proud. I got to be honest with you. She's getting a pony this year. She said, well, Jesus gives us the stuff that we need. Santa gives us the stuff that we wish for. And I said, wow, she's going to be a preacher one day. I like that. Here's what we miss. There is a major difference between needs and wants. Some of the things you want, but you don't need. And some of the things you need, you probably don't want. Now, I'm going to tell you something about myself that many of you probably don't know. When I was a child, I was very hyperactive. And as a child, I required a lot of attention. I know that comes as a shock to most of you today, but I was a hyper-hypo. And I had a lot of energy, and so because of that, I did some things. I would get bored, and I would do some things. So like one day I thought it'd be cool to take an entire can of gasoline and just pour it all over the garage. Right? Nothing wrong with that. And then another day, I thought it'd be cool to, I saw this cat playing in a bush outside of our house, so I thought it'd be cool to grab the cat by the tail and swing it around like, you know, lasso. That didn't work out too good either. But I got into a lot of stuff. And because of that, I got a lot of discipline. Now, when it came time for discipline, my dad got very patriotic. He gave me stripes and I saw stars. That's the best I got today, folks. I'm just going to tell you right there. That's the best preacher joke you're getting today. And you know what? At the moment when I was a kid, my dad would say, I'm doing this, son, because I love you. And I'm thinking, you got a messed up view of love, buddy. See, I didn't want discipline, but I needed it. And it took me to get older and look back over my life and to see that there was something that I didn't really want, but I really needed. And James 1:17 says, every good gift and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In other words, God is not in heaven running around trying to fill the wants of a bunch of snotty-nosed Christians. No, God is a good parent. He's not just a good parent, he's a great parent. And he doesn't always give you what you want, but God is always ready to provide what you need. And there are many of you today saying, I want to be married. And God says, but you need to be whole before you get married. But God, I want to be married. Get whole first. You let me make you whole, because if I let you go broken into that marriage, you're just going to have a broken marriage. So I got to make you whole before you get into the marriage. Learn to appreciate what you need, and then I'll give you what you want. God, I want to be out of debt. I want to have a job where I make more money than I know what to do with. And God says, but what you need to do is learn how to be disciplined with what you have. Because if I can't trust you in little things, how am I going to trust you with big things? Here's the good news about God. Many times when I show appreciation for what I needed, it leads to what I wanted. So if Sage wants to argue today about, I ain't eating my vegetables, I want ice cream, give me graters, I want ice cream. You know what we're going to look at Sage, because we're good parents? We're going to say, no, you don't get ice cream because you didn't eat your vegetables. But if Sage is disciplined in eating her vegetables that she needs, more often than not, she's going to get ice cream later. God's the same way, folks. Learn to appreciate what he's given you that you need. And it'll lead oftentimes to what you want. That's what the Bible says. He will give us the desires of our heart. Here's my final difference. Final difference between Santa and the Savior. And they can come to the music. When I begin to think about the similarities of Santa and the Savior, I thought, well, they both have beards. I mean, Santa, Savior, it both starts with an S. They're both celebrated at this time of year. But I think this was the biggest difference that I could find. On Christmas morning, when you wake up, you'll run downstairs and you will look under the tree and you will see gifts that Santa has left you underneath the tree. But God didn't leave his gift under a tree. He put his gift on the tree. And when he lifted it up, he said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. See, to find God's greatest gift, you don't go searching underneath a tree hoping that the next present you unwrap is the one that you really want. No, all you got to do is look up, because God's gift is hanging on the tree just for you. Jesus, his sole purpose was that he was born to die. Born to die. That was his purpose. And after he died, he arose again. Romans chapter 5. This is what it says, beginning with verse 6. For while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, one would dare even to die. Verse 8, but God, somebody say, but God, shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. See, Jesus didn't wait for you to believe in him. He believed in you. He didn't wait for you to get everything worked out in your life. No, he already worked it out. And while you're searching for gifts under a tree, God says, I wish you would lift your eyes this season, and I wish you would see the greatest gift. The greatest gift is the gift I hung on the tree. And I hung him there for you. Just for you. Your attention just for a moment, because I'm going to wrap this up. I want to give you the greatest question. The greatest question is about Christ. Is he the Son of God? Many of you are asking this today. Is Jesus Christ the Son of God? Or is he the sum of our dreams? Is he the force of creation? Or is he a figment of our imagination? Well, if we were to ask that same question about Santa Claus, the answer is he is the culmination of our desires. He is a depiction of our fondest dreams. You see, when you see Santa Claus, what you see is mankind's idea of what a Savior should look like. When you see Santa Claus, you see mankind's greatest dream of how a Savior would act. But even in our greatest effort, the best we could come up with is a hero that only shows up one time a year. But it's not so when you ask about Jesus. No one could dream up a person as incredible as he is. The idea that a poor virgin girl would be selected by God to bear himself. The notion that God would don a scalp and fingers and toes and two eyes. The thought that the king of the universe would sneeze and burp and get bit by mosquitoes. It's too incredible. Too revolutionary. We would never create a savior like that. It's far too daring. But God did. God did what we wouldn't dare to dream. He did what we could never imagine. He became one of us so that we could trust him. He became a sacrifice so we could know him. And then he defeated death so that we could follow him. When Christmas is over, you will be left with presents, T.S. You know what's going to happen with them presents? Santa has a way. I'm not sure how he figured out how to do this, but Santa has a way of leaving all these gifts under the tree and somehow slipping mom and dad the bill. We'll have a conversation with him about that. Mom and dad is funding Santa Claus. We gotta. You see, the gift that God hung on the tree was paying your bill. It was a bill you could never pay. You could never afford. And God said, the gift I'm going to give you has already been paid in full. And not only has it been paid in full, it is paying in full for you. For where sin did abound, grace does much more abound. God saying, I paid a debt that you couldn't pay. I paid a debt that I didn't know because it was a debt that you couldn't pay. And now what's God asking? He is saying, by the end of the day today, you may leave CityGate Church and you may leave here holding on to some presents. T.S. Now you can go home and all you can look forward to this Christmas is presents. T.S. from Santa Claus. Or you could leave here with presents. The presence of God. The presence of the Holy Spirit. The presence of the Prince of Peace. The presence of joy. The presence of unity and love. You could leave with that today. But God says, I'll hang them on a tree and I'll leave it up to you who you're going to worship this season. Everybody is worshiping something. Everybody. And I'm going to give you an invitation to choose the gift that God hung on the tree. I'm going to give you an invitation to choose presence over presents, T.S. Have you accepted God's gift that he hung on a tree just for you? Every head bowed, every eye closed, nobody looking around. This is between you and God right now. If you're in here and you have never accepted the gift of the Savior, Jesus Christ, the Lamb slain from the foundations of the world, but you want to receive Him today. You want to go through this Christmas with the presence, not the gifts, but the presence of God, knowing that your sins are forgiven, knowing that the unlimited presence of God is surrounding your life, knowing that He's given you a gift that you couldn't earn, a gift that you didn't deserve, knowing that you're receiving the gift that God hung on a tree just for you. There are many of you that you've come to Christmas services over and over and over again and left the same way, but I don't want that to be your story today. I want you to leave changed by the Savior. He came, He died, He was buried, and He arose just for you. And today He says, receive this gift of everlasting life. If that's you, I'm going to count to three. And when I do, I just want you to raise your hand up high. And I want you to say, yes, I want to receive the gift that God hung on the tree just for me. I want to know that I've made Jesus the Lord and the Savior of my life, especially during the season, but not just this season, but for years to come. I want to know that I have a home in heaven when this life is over. If that's you, I want you to raise your hand up high on the count of three. Nobody looking around. This is between you and God. Are you ready? Are you ready? Raise it up high. Don't wonder if anybody else is going to raise their hand, because they wouldn't go to hell for you. Don't go to hell for them. I want you to go to heaven today. Are you ready? When I count to three, raise it up high. One, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Two, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. Are you ready? One, two, three, shoot it up high. Thank you, thank you. Oh my goodness, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Hands are going up all over. Hands are going. I'm going to invite everyone to stand with me right now. Everybody in this room, I want you to stand with me right now, if you will. Come on. And now I want to see if you really mean business this morning. I know this is going to be a huge step. It's going to be a huge challenge. But I want to see if you really mean business. If you raised your hand, I want you to take your family or friend who's around you, and I want you to come meet me down at this altar this morning. Will you do that? Come on. Step out in an aisle right now and come down and meet me in this altar. Come on right now. If you raise your hand up high, we're going to give you as much time as you need. Come down here. Come on. Come on, City Gate. Let's celebrate. Come on. There were about 50 hands in this room that went up. I want you to step out. Family, come with them. Friends, come with them. Don't let them come by themselves. Yeah, hey, listen, we ought to be celebrating right now. This is what Christmas is really all about. Come on, get excited in here. He is God. God with us. Come on, if you raised your hand up, come down right now. Folks, you can spread out all across the aisle here. Come on, spread out all across the altar. Spread out. I want one line. Give me one line. Give me one line all across the altar here. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Give me some of our prayer team down here to pray with them, some of these that are coming down. Come on. Move on down. Ushers, help me out. Move on down. We got them lined up in the aisle. Let's move on down. Come on. Help me out, elders. Help me out, ushers. Let's move them down. If you're thinking about it right now, I want you to take somebody by the hand. Bring them down here with you. Don't leave this place until you have received the Savior. The Savior. Come on right now. We're going to pray in just a moment. I want you to turn to somebody, and I want you to ask them, and I want you to do it in love. I want you to ask them, have you received the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ? Have you made Him the Lord of your life? And if they can't say yes, will you just invite them to come down to the altar with you, and will you bring them down here today? Let's do that right now. Turn and ask somebody, because I don't want anyone to leave this place that hasn't received the invitation, the greatest invitation of this season. They're going to sing it one more time. This is your opportunity to come. Don't leave here without making the Lord of your life. you're standing down here today, first off, thank you. Thank you for accepting the invitation. That's a big walk you just took, and we celebrate you today and your decision that you made. Come on, CityGate. Let them know. Praise God. So we rejoice with you today. Thank you for receiving the gift of everlasting life. Now here's what's going to happen. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. I'm just going to give you the words to say. I want you to know it's not a prayer that saves you. It is what you believe in your heart. See, the Bible says, believe in your heart, confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you shall be saved. I'm just going to lead you in a prayer to do that. Are you ready? I'm going to invite everybody. Those of you watching online, I'm going to invite you. Pray with us right there in your home. This is the greatest gift that you could receive this Christmas. Is Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world. We're going to pray. Are you ready? Every head bowed, every eyes closed, let's pray. Dear Jesus, I am a sinner in need of a Savior. I thank you that you came to earth, that you were born in a lowly manger. And you did that so that everyone could approach you. Jesus, you lived a sinless life. And you died for me. And you were buried for me. But on the third day, you arose for me. And I receive your gift of life. I ask you, forgive me, wash me, cleanse me, erase my past. Thank you for creating in me a new heart and a new mind and giving me a fresh start. Satan, I renounce you. You are not my God, and I will not serve you. Jesus, I proclaim that you are, from this day and forevermore, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords of my life. Now give him the biggest praise you've given him.